Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to welcome you to our 13th policy series. And today we speak about the program of the French government for its EU presidency, with a specific focus, obviously, on the fields of banking and financial market. We have been having a policy series on EU presidencies now for the fourth time. After the ones for Germany, Portugal and Slovenia, we are now interested in hearing what the French government plans to do in this particular field. With France, the EU now has a central state having the respective presidency, and therefore, obviously, the expectations are very high. We're very curious on the plans of the French government for its presidency, which also takes time at a crucial moment since France is going to the polls in a few months' time. I also would like to remind you that the EU has always got a trio presidency. So the one of France is always coordinated together with the Czech and the Swedish one, which will follow after the first French presidency in the second half of this year and in the first half of 2023. So welcome to all of you. And I would like to specifically welcome our keynote speaker, Sébastien Raspelier. Welcome, Sébastien, and thanks for participating in this call. In terms of introduction, Sébastien is the head of the Financial Sector Directorate in the Directorate General of the Treasury, the French Ministry of Economy and Finance and Relance. Sébastien was previously head of the Insurance Markets and Products Unit and of the Corporate Financing Unit at the Directorate General of the Treasury, where he also served as a General Secretary of the Interministerial Committee for Industrial Restructuring. He holds a degree from the École Polytechnique. So thanks very much for joining, Sébastien. I also see that Peter Simon has joined. I would suggest I will introduce him after your keynote speech for the introduction, and then we will basically have a short co-discussant speech by Peter, and then we can go into the Q&A session. So thanks very much for participating, and I hand over to you, Sébastien.
Thank you very much, Thomas, and thank you for having invited me to speak to this event of EBI. I will describe, generally speaking, the main priorities of the French presidency of the EU Council. I try to leave time for questions. So I will try to remain brief. The French presidency of the EU Council has begun on the 1st of January and will end at the 14th of June. I remain sad because sometimes I'm asked whether our national elections will have an impact on our presidency of the EU Council. It has, of course, an impact regarding the political impulse for our presidency, and major events, political events, are gathered in January, February, and March. And as you might be aware, President Macron has called for a summit of EU head of states on the 10th and 11th of March. At the end of this week, we will hold the informal ECOFIN in Paris. And we hold recently a conference on EU sovereignty in digital affairs. And we'll hold also a conference beginning of March on a green and sustainable agenda. So that, of course, is quite a short agenda, a short period of time to hold so many events, but it gave also, I hope, quite a political impulse for the political priorities that the that President Macron has recalled end of last year. Regarding our job as a honest broker for making moving forward within the Council all the pieces of legislation that the Commission was so kind to table, we will do our best until the very last day, and national elections, we won't change anything on that. We have many texts on the table. And one of my duty is to be sure that on the one hand, we keep in mind within the Council the political priorities as set by ministers in ECOFIN Council, so be it for Basel, for solvency, and so on, for CMU package. And the second, of course, taking into account all the technicalities that member states are putting forward in order to be able to find compromises, the best compromises possible, and if possible, also fast. So we would like to have some general approaches and end of trialogues under our presidency. If I go briefly on each general item, we have a first package with digital finance. We have entered into trialogues on DORA, so the cyber resilience, that's something important in our view, that is also linked to digital in a more, in a broader way. We are hopeful to end trialogues end of March, beginning of April. At least we will hold by then a second political trialogue, but technical trialogues are progressing quite well. We are waiting for the European Parliament position on MiCA. As you know, Council has reached a general approach on the Slovenian presidency. We hope that European Parliament can now make swift progress on this issue, since we think at the Council level that it's important to have as soon as possible a regulatory framework on crypto assets. We are mindful also that there is an international track of work to make progress on that, but we need to have already one in European Union as soon as possible. And then, of course, I don't forget the EU pilot regime, but it was achieved under the Slovenian presidency. For the sustainable finance package, so another horizontal package, and with digital, the two main priorities set at the European Union level. We are also, of course, waiting for the process on the taxonomy to be achieved, but that's not a duty for presidency of the Council. Now we are really much engaged into achieving corporate sustainability reporting directive. We hope for an agreement at the Competitiveness Council this week, so on the 24th. And we also expect the European Parliament to achieve an agreement by April in the plenary, so that we can engage in trialogues and, if possible, end them by summer. And if really possible, under our presidency, that would be great. EU green bond standards, also an important topic. Here, let's see, it's for the ECOFIN Council, probably not March, but we hope for the one in April. And of course, beyond that, there are probably plenty of initiatives to take on board, to impulse at European, but also to national domestic levels, so that this new grammar, I would say, can really be embarked at the corporate level. That's the most important thing. Beyond designing legislation and regulation, it's also important to ensure that in the end users and producers are taking that on board. Regarding more specifically financial services legislation, we have in all fields a very important topic. Let me maybe begin very briefly with one on AML and CFT. It's of course very important, based on quite a consensus among member states that we can only do better. But here, the devil is in the detail, as always, and we should ensure that in the end, the results provide results, and that with that framework in place, we can answer with confidence that the scandals that we experienced some years ago in European Union could not happen anymore in European Union. So that's a big challenge, of course, big responsibility, but it has to be a result-driven agenda. Then in banking affairs, and that's where most interest for you and the audience, you all know what is on the table. Basel III banking package, more generally, very big chunk of legislation. Ideas among member states, I can say that I think that there is a common understanding that the Commission has really worked a lot and quite well before tabling its proposal. And my guess would be that the end result of the negotiations would result in something not that different from the balance that the Commission has proposed first. So within the Council, we are achieving next month the technical screening of the package. And we'll begin starting in April to propose some compromise packages, partial one probably, and see whether there could be a confirmed common understanding that this kind of balance is the one to be able to move forward. Here the issue is rather simple, I would say, even if it will still remain quite complex. But either some member states or the parliament, but it will be up to the parliament to check, but within the council, either some member states really want to move the balance proposed by the commission quite far away. Then let's see, but my guess would be that it would stuck the discussion for many months. Or whether there is an agreement that we should refine, precise, enhance a little bit, but not that much the proposal by the Commission. And in such a case, then we would be more confident that a timely transposition of Basel agreement can be achieved. So let's see, happy to talk a little bit more about that if you want during the Q&A session. Then we have a consumption credit and so on, so working on. One word on banking union, it's not a duty for the French EU presidency of the Council, it's a duty of the president of the Eurogroup, so he's working very hard on that. Happy also to discuss a little bit on during the Q&A session. But my view is that we really need to separate the two tracks, on one hand banking union, second banking package, and that it's easier to have a better understanding on banking union if we have already clearer ideas on what will be the impact of banking package on the medium to long run. Then we also have a lot of proposals by the Commission on the table regarding capital market union. I will be a little bit briefer on that. I include in this package Solvency II too, because we need capital if you want a capital market union. And capital can be brought by savers through insurance products, so through insurers. We have also asset management with LTIF and IFMD review. Here also, I mean, the idea is to have more capital, more long-term capital, and a stronger asset management industry. So MiFIR review and market structure, that can be of interest for banks too. Here, it's important to be aware also of what the UK can do with the wholesale market review. So it will probably take some time to achieve a general approach, probably not under our presidency, but it's important to begin with a better common understanding of what is at stake in market structure. And then we have the issue of consolidated tape, as well as European single access points, two concrete initiatives to enhance the functioning of European capital markets. ConsoTape is a tricky topic, but again, we are devoted to enhance the common understanding of why it could be useful and how it can be useful. And for European single access points, I mean, we built on a strong consensus, but devil is in the detail, as always, and so we have to ensure that we give ESMA the legislative framework that can enable them to develop that at least one part very fast and with a good with something that can be directly useful for the asset management industry and in the end the end retail savers. So briefly speaking, we have all that. Our motto, and we will try to develop that during the informal ECOFIN, is that we have experienced 15 years ago a great financial crisis, which came from the US, which was due to many things. I will not recall all of that, but it would be a mistake in our view if the European Union and European authorities and national authorities within let still think that we have done nothing. Of course, we can say that banking union is not complete, that we have not achieved a genuine capital market union and so on. But what we have observed, and we have a real stress test last year and 2020, is that the European financial sector was strong and has resisted to this real stress test. So there were progresses made, and we should acknowledge that. And second, when we think of our challenges for the future, the huge need of investment for succeeding or hoping to succeed in the green and digital transition, that we have to rely on the financial sector, which should be still part of the solution now, and be made stronger. So stronger means more resilient, for sure, but also more competitive, more profitable. And that's why we call for an acknowledgement that we should preferably think forward-looking rather than discuss eternally of what was quick reactions after the great financial crisis. 15 years ago, if we still discuss about that, that's a signal of failure, big failure, and beyond that, that shows that sends a very negative signal about not having at our disposal one important tool to succeed in our future challenges. Because if you cannot rely on private finance, then you have to rely on public finance. You see that it would create a lot of debate, very sensitive, but also sensible ones. So it's better to be able to rely on two engines. And here, when we think of European Union, the biggest part of savings and still major reliance, dependence on third party actors and savings for financing risk-taking in Europe in a nutshell. So huge challenges, and try to coordinate between the big thinking politicians, at least mine, and on the second hand, a lot of legislative files, which for many of them are very, very technical. So thank you very much, and happy to discuss further with you.
Thanks very much, Sebastian, for your presentation and for the introduction to the program. We will go into the Q&A session a little bit later, but let me now first of all introduce Peter Simon. Hello, Peter.
Hello.
Thanks for joining this event as well. Let me just introduce you. Peter Simon is the Managing Director of the World Savings Banking Institute, as well as the European Savings and Retail Banking Group. Moreover, Peter Simon was a member of the European Parliament for the Social Democratic Party of Germany for 10 years from 2009 to 2019, so up until very recently, where he was also Deputy Chairman of the Committee of Economic and Monetary Affairs. And last year, he was awarded with the German Federal Cross of Merit for his work in the European Parliament. So congratulations also on this, Peter. And Mr. Simon holds a law degree from the Ruprecht Karls University in Heidelberg. So again, thanks very much for joining. And I'm sure you also have a lot of, let's say, wish list for the presidency, but we're very happy to listen now to your statement in relation to the program of the French presidency for the EU. Thanks very much, Peter, and I hand over to you.
Thank you very much for inviting me, Thomas, and thanks as well for organizing this very interesting debate. And I'm really delighted to be here today. It was all very relevant what Sebastian just elaborated on. It is my expectation, and it is met, that the French presidency has quite a number of different priorities and files to follow up on, not only in the financial services sector, but also well beyond. And Sebastian gave us a perfect overview of many of the financial services related work streams. Sebastian, and I would like to comment on a few of them from the perspectives of savings and retail banks, and also at other topics where I know that you will work on. So one of the most important dossiers on which Sebastian's and his colleagues in the Council are currently working on is undoubtedly the implementation of the final elements of Basel. And not just the member states, but also ESBG members are analyzing the proposal which the Commission presented in October and assessing where some additional fine-tuning may be needed. Let me get things straight. There are a lot of good elements in the Commission's proposal, and we appreciate the effort from the Commission to take into consideration specific characteristics of the European financial system. For example, the SME and the infrastructure supporting factors are maintained. We appreciate that the application of the output floor is envisaged as in the Basel text, namely at the highest level of consolidation. Something that we welcome less, as you can imagine, is the fact that the Commission proposed to the so-called single stack approach for the output floor, which would mean applying the floor to EU-specific components of the capital requirements on top of internationally agreed ones, instead of using the output floor as a backstop by applying it to internationally agreed capital requirements only. Yeah? This is simply unfair for European banks. Furthermore, reading through the proposal, it becomes apparent that for institutions using only the standardized approach for credit risk, the implementation will not be cautioned through transitional arrangements. For them, the granularity of the framework will increase drastically as of 2025. This will create significant challenges in the implementation and lastly result in a disproportionate burden. I wish you the best of luck, Sebastian, to make progress on this complex dossier. I could only pick up a few aspects, such as the output floor of or the transitional arrangements for now, but there are many more details that deserve close attention. I still recall from my time as a rapporteur in the European Parliament how sensitive and controversial the discussions quite often turned out. I'm sure that you will do the utmost possible, and I wish you good luck for this. As we will be talking about sustainability and technological aspects a little bit later, let me for now perhaps comment on two other dossiers. First, for us important during the French presidency is also the Consumer Credit Directive. This is a very complex file, and again, I would say that the Commission's proposal has its ups, but it has also its downs. To mention a positive example in the spirit of same business, same risks, same rules, we appreciate that the scope of application of the directive will likely be extended to actors beyond traditional banks. This is also important from a level playing field perspective, and I understand that member states are also not contesting this. Apart from that, in the context of information duties, ESBG members are concerned that the introduction of an additional single European consumer credit overview, the so-called SECO, would overwhelm a consumer. It's an additional document to read, and the information would have to be repeated elsewhere in more detail. We really hope that this idea is not taken up, but rather to have just the standard European consumer credit information, the SECI, with which consumers are completely familiar. Second dossier I like to come on is the anti-money laundering legislative package. I'm sure we all agree that it is of utmost importance to close loopholes in the European regulatory landscape. History must not repeat itself. In this respect, ESBG fully supports the Commission's recent legislative package, and we are hopeful that it will strengthen the fight against financial crime. We also call for a clear regulation and an efficient responsibility sharing between the different authorities. The proposal for an EU-wide anti-money laundering authority is a great opportunity to ensure consistent supervisory practices and a comprehensive view of current and emerging risk. I've been for many years the coordinator of my group in the European Parliament, and especially on these files here, our special committees that we had dealing with money laundering. This proposal is also, from my personal experience, a very, very helpful and important one. But nevertheless, overlaps with national authorities must be avoided, and centralization should not come at the cost of efficiency. A close cooperation among all stakeholders, well beyond the traditional banking sector, is needed to jointly succeed in the fight against money laundering. In this sense, we are also happy to see that the Council is supportive of the idea of introducing an obligation for crypto asset service providers to collect and make accessible full information about the sender and beneficiary of the transfers. It would be indeed strange if crypto asset service providers wouldn't be among the obliged entities which are required to apply AML measures, including carrying out customers' due diligence and, in case of suspicions, to report these suspicions to FIUs. Just as on Basel, I wish you, Sebastian, the best of luck to advance also this dossier in the Council, and I emphasize that savings and retail banks are standing behind you regarding when it comes to developing sensible additions to the regulatory framework. I think I'll stop here, and I look forward to discussion. But once again, to you, Thomas, thank you for enabling us these important topics today.
Thanks very much, Peter, for your presentation. And I suggest we come now to our Q&A session. Also to the audience, we have a Q&A tool, so you can always ask your questions directly to the audience, to the speakers. If you direct who you want to ask, or if it's to both of them, just let me know. And if it fits into the current discussion we are having, then obviously I will read this aloud. But let me start first of all with a question to Sebastian, if I may. So I've seen that in your program, you also would like to see the increased competitiveness of the European economy as one of the objectives of your program. Yeah, could you provide us with a bit more assessment on the identified gaps within the EU banking system, to be concrete now, and linking it to the banking system, the gaps in the banking system and how it could be more efficient in supporting the EU economy?
Thank you very much, Thomas, for this question. I will take two examples, one quite global, one more specific. 2021, due to an external shock, unforeseeable, we have experienced dash for cash by corporates. And here, I think that European banks were able, generally speaking, to face this demand. When you look into more details, what you observe is that first, for large corporates, it's necessarily a European dimension. So it's not a German large corporate asking for German bonds, a Dutch large corporate asking for Dutch banks, and so be it, including for French large corporates asking only for French banks. So one observation. Then the big ask is, if we do nothing, if we do business as usual for the next decade, and that we experienced another shock, similar in its magnitude, unforeseeable external shock, do we think that we still be able to rely on a European banking system supplying them? It's a tough question to answer. I'm not sure to have all the details to be able to answer with certainty. But I have doubt. So, I mean, no complacency on that, but it's not about saying we should think as if this question does not exist and as if we are still in 2012, I would say. Change is evolving. We have green transition, digital transition, the fact that the EU is in between China and the US, that we see that from a geopolitical perspective, that can raise very serious questions, issues, and are we fit? So, one much more specific example. I'm told that for mid large cap in Europe to raise capital on markets, they necessarily have to rely on at least one US bank. Because of what? Two things. One, US banks are able to take on their balance sheet such risk because that's their model, to keep on the balance sheet quite risky businesses. That's absolutely not the one of European banks. And second, because large US banks can rely on large asset managers of their own, which are quite involved in equity. We have in Europe large European banks which own asset management, but which are not really fit for equity. And we have large open banks, but whose balance sheet is quite full. So the question of, do we really want this situation? If it's true, to stay like this? And that's a question that I have not seen in the debate. And that's probably an issue. So if we think that, you might understand, I think that, and I think it's important to find solutions and handle the situation on that, it's probably needed to enhance competitiveness of EU banks. When saying that, it's good for financial stability. It's maybe not necessary to for each EU bank, but at least for EU banks which can serve the needs of corporates that are financing their growth, including mid large cap. So on this, you have different banking models, but in the end, what we really want is some of the EU banks able to achieve also services, to get services that European clients can meet. So that's two examples, one for the next decade, and I think it's really important to be able to answer to it. If we had found ourselves in 2020 in a situation where the EU banking sector was not able finance the dash for cash, we would be right now facing quite more difficult topics. So that's always an issue of balance. I think that we need to make our narrative evolve towards more forward looking. That's not an issue of deregulation versus more regulation. That's not an issue of trying to tweak this or that. It's an issue of saying, okay, banking union, very good, but what for? Because we are just saying banking union, but we sometimes forget what is under this two words. And sometimes you might ask whether it's really good or not for for this goal, forward-looking goal. Second, we really need to be able to rely on some strong European actors whose base is in Europe. And so in times of difficulty, you know that they're here. It's not about being against third country banks or service providers, but just to say, to acknowledge that in times of difficulty, you can rely on your own, and that's pretty much. So if we have important goals at the economic level for Europe, you cannot think of achieving them with a weak financial sector. So that's basically that.
Thanks very much, Sebastian. Peter, do you want to jump in as well? Otherwise, I have also other questions. Okay, good. Then actually, I have the first question now from the audience. Fiona Maxwell was asking, could both speakers talk a bit more about the changes that would ideally like to see in the Basel, I guess the CRR3 and CRD6 proposal. Martin Malin has been presenting his proposal, or the Commission's proposal, at the end of last year. So now the question is, what would you ideally like to be changed in this proposal? I would ask this to both participants. Maybe Sebastian, you want to start?
So as a presidency of the council, I have a duty of neutrality. So that holds for our presidency. So after, we will speak again. But before, we have already spoken, and I believe that French positions are well known. That's always an issue of balance. Just to say that what we think is important is for co-legislators to make sure that in the end, the way the Basel Agreement is transposed in European Union law respects the political mandate. And the political mandate given by the treaty and recalled by ECOFIN Council is, okay, finalizing Basel III agreement while not creating significant capital requirement increase and preserving level playing field. On these two aspects, the first one, can debate about what is significant or non-significant capital requirement increase. I usually take the example of taxes. If you ask people whether they think that a 10% tax increase is significant or non-significant, you know that it will be said significant. But for your neighbor or from another perspective, it can be seen as non-significant. Maybe it's a figure that can be thought as sensible one. But of course, you have the fact that it has to remain risk-based. And so that when you see divergence, differences, sometimes huge, due to banking models, for instance, that are not correlated to the risk sensitivity, it's hard to understand that, and it's hard from a political point of view to defend that. Here, one aspect, very, very easy. when people complain of not getting a credit, they do not send their letters to governors or central banks. They send them to ministers because they're in the end the one responsible to the citizens. That's the way it is, and that's normal. So no problem with that. But at least for ministers, it's necessary in such a case to be able to explain why you have such a result. And sometimes it's like, you know, an algorithm that you do not understand the output. If you think of applying, for instance, output floor at solo level, pure solo level, as not the ECB, but many national domestic supervisors have called for, then you know, even if ABA and no one has really done carried out an impact study, but you know for sure that you will have huge differences in the capital requirement impact according only to the banking model structure. And do you think that, you know, cooperative mutual bank is necessarily due to this structure riskier than something else? Probably not. I hope not. So, I mean, we have to be careful of that, because if in the end we have something that is not risk-based anymore, it's not possible anymore for a minister to explain that to a citizen, and then Basel III will end in 10 years, 20 years, as something that could not be supported anymore. So, I mean, that's why it's really important to on some topics to really be able to still explain why we have such impact, and then we are able to defend them. So that's one very important point. The second one, level playing field. I mean, we know, for instance, for market activities, that it's very, very sensitive to some differences in the regulation. European Union is the first major jurisdiction to act. I do not understand why we sometimes are so defensive regarding other jurisdictions which have not yet doubled what they will do. I don't know what the US, the UK will do. I do not take as granted that they will stick to Basel agreement without any deviation. And for market activity, when I see the US putting the alpha factor of SECCR to one in a permanent way, I do not see how we can respect the political mandate of G20 if we do not put this factor also in a permanent way at the same level. And that's a very important topic because, as I mentioned, if in the end we are not careful about that, we could end up in 10 years with all large EU corporates which would be in need for doing IPOs, for doing capital increases on the market to rely only on Swiss banks. If that's what we want, we should be it would be better to acknowledge that right now and to be aware of that. My fear is that it's not the case, and so we will need to be able to think of that also from this perspective, because really whether it's against or for multilateralism to put alpha factor at 1 or 1.4, I think we have other fields where we can experience a better use of multilateralism. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sebastian. Peter, then I would hand it over to you. You mentioned already in your initial remarks that the output floor is something you're not 100% happy with, but maybe you can dig into this a bit more in depth and also mention other points which are a key concern for the banks that you represent.
Yeah, let's come back to this, the parallel stack approach. And there you can mix both the questions. Yeah, because for sure, let's speaking about sustainability, it's clear everybody has to do its best. And only if one party does not do its best, it's not a reason for the others to stay behind what is needed by nature, what is needed to avoid climate change. But then at least we have to look that everywhere where we can avoid that it comes to unfair situation where we can avoid lose a level playing field, that we are careful here. And the parallel stack approach is exactly one example for this. Why should the Europeans take also here within a single stack approach a burden on their shoulder in addition to what is needed and asked for by Basel because of our own European legislation that nobody questions? But why don't we stick here only to what is agreed on Basel? What the Commission does here is a gold plating, and we should not go beyond Basel. We don't ask for staying behind Basel, but we ask the legislators not to go beyond what Basel requires. Looking what changes we would like to see in addition, for sure, transitional arrangements for unrated corporates and mortgage, or look at the fit and proper assessment of the key function holders. So for the board members, for example, here we would like to be clear that it's normal that we have an ex ante check, but it has to be absolutely possible also to have an ex post check. Why? Look, look at the European banking sector. Look at these many countries like Germany, for example, that have a public banking sector. Look at countries where you have wire legislation, for example, a Lord Mayor at the top of a supervisory board of a public-owned saving bank. So should only candidates for getting Lord Mayors be allowed that could stand a fit and proper assessment? No. It has to be made clear that an elected person who has the obligation by law to get in a function in a bank gets then all he needs to fulfill all the obligations there, but ex post and not ex ante, because these people who apply for a Lord Mayor's post, for example, or the regional president of a county, they don't apply to get the head of a supervisory board of a public bank. It's the consequence by law. So here we would be happy to have, beside the ex ante aspect, a clear possibility for an ex post variant. I think these are the main topics for the moment. We can raise many other fields, the field of equity, lower risk weight, so 100% for long-term strategic investments we would like to have in the proposal too. Many other things could be mentioned, but I think the ones I mentioned were the key ones.
Thank you very much, Peter. Then maybe let's move on to CMU. Sebastian, you also mentioned Capital Markets Union is one of a key priority for the European economy, for the banking system, but it has been already a priority for some time right now. But what I would like to know is, what is in the new CMU action plan, let's say, how would it contribute to the recovery of the EU economy, and what is the impact that you will see this may have on the EU banking system?
Well, thank you, Thomas. You were well aware of the efforts made by the Commission to make progress on capital market union agenda. But here, that will be one important point of the second session of informal ECOFIN at the end of the week. That we want to focus probably more on capital markets and banking per se. For two reasons. The first one is, we know that for financing disruptions, technologies and so on, bank financing cannot be the only answer. So it's not an issue of bank versus capital markets. It's really an issue of having a whole bunch of financing means that we need for financing these transitions and future growth. On that, you cannot rely probably only on an EU level top-down approach, because you don't create capital markets, you don't increase in a structural way its deepness, liquidity through regulation. That might help to avoid unnecessary burdens, while keeping, of course, financial stability and investor protection at the heart of the legislation. But you cannot expect to create that from from legislation only. Second, if you want to develop capital markets, you need more capital. And so it's good to work on financial intermediates, but it's also very good to work on the sources of capital. And here, that's retail savers, financial intermediation, but for savings, and then also attractiveness for foreign investment, foreign savers. And if you want that to take place on EU bank capital markets, competitiveness and efficiency of EU capital markets. Here, the departure of the UK is, of course, a very important event, since the UK was, in some segments, quite the only player in the European Union. So we need to develop a lot of things, not for the pleasure of developing capital markets, but for being able to finance future EU needs. For this, you need political support. When you explain like this, at least for me, with my minister, I gain support. But when my minister is with his colleagues and that they hear about capital markets union, it's really hard for them to understand. If you talk about MIFIR, about ESAP, about consolidated tape, and so on, do really someone think that there will be a debate about consolidated tape at the ECOFIN? So, I mean, we really need to make them think in their own terms why it's important to really make their political support more robust, more permanent. And for them also to do something at national level. Because when you think of retail participation, of having savings maybe a little bit more oriented for some of them towards financing private equity, financing of startup scale-ups, and so on. Here, I mean, that's more probably more domestic than EU. The markets in this field are quite fragmented, but I mean, that's not an issue necessarily to make progress. So probably trying to be more pragmatic, acknowledging that the EU Commission is really doing a good work. Proposals we have four on the table. We really want to make progress maximum of them. So LTIF, IFND, MIFIR review, and ESAP. But in the end, it's also a call to market participants, to banks, to domestic programs, savings, and so on, to develop EU capital markets. One specific word on that, maybe. One way to make a link between banks and capital markets is clear, that's securitization. There will be a review by the Commission next year. Here, just some thoughts. STS program was called for at the very beginning by ECB and Bank of England. So, I mean, it was not something made by proponents of capital markets per se, of big capitalists, and because it was seen as a necessity. When you look at the figures of securitization right now, I don't think that we can say it's a success. So if the call at the time was right, then it's still valid, I think. It's probably not the STS regulation per se that's an issue. You have issues with prudential requirement on the bank side, probably even more on the insurer side or investor side, because you still have a stigma on that past negotiations have not erased entirely. But if we think that it's necessary in order to ease the job for banks in the future and to develop EU capital markets in order to better finance EU growth and so on, if there is an economic case, then there should be something done probably about that next year. So that will not be for EU French EU presidency of the Council, but that can be a call for next presidencies.
Thanks very much, Sebastian. Looking at the time, I think we have time for one more question. Peter, if I may, one of the big topics in the whole banking industry at the moment is obviously this whole area around digital transformation and then green transition. Yeah. And what I would be interested in, how do you see these two global trends are affecting the business models of the savings and the retail banks? Yeah. And what are the forces reshaping the industry as we know it right now in terms of competition and its contribution to the EU economy? And then if I may also include one point that was included into this question by Daniel Gluch as a question in the Q&A tool. How do European banks stand versus US banks in terms of level playing field, in particular when it comes to the green transition part?
Yeah, there's an undeniable trend that consumers visit their bank branches less and less often. And for sure, this raises challenges. On the one hand, in order to remain cost efficient, banks have to optimize their branch network. And this means that some branches are being closed when other distribution relation channels can replace them in a proper way. However, as savings and retail banks, we are committed at maintaining the capillary coverage of our branch network, which characterizes our regional identity. On the other hand, we need to increase our reach via our digital channels. However, these digital channels are not always best positioned for the provision of more complex products such as mortgages, and here the loss of physical contact with our customers is simply not an option. This loss would reduce our capabilities to advise and to suggest products that are tailored to our customers' need. Furthermore, whilst in the past the customer would visit a bank branch once per week or a couple of times per month, modern customers log into their bank apps almost once per day to check their balances and to perform transactions. Our challenge is to convert these more frequent interactions into business opportunities. And this also brings opportunities to preserve our responsible role in the digital society. Let's take, for example, the increasing popularity of the so-called buy now, pay later products. Claiming to be payment products, the business models of these providers are built on the concept of making consumers buy things they don't need with money they don't have. These providers are actually providing consumer credit in disguise and have possible over indebtedness as a result. Savings and retail banks know their clients thoroughly and can properly advise their customers prudently whether it makes sense to buy on credit on a case-by-case basis. Tailor-made advising customers also makes sense in other areas, such investments in crypto assets, where there are a lot of Wild West actors out there who just are after our customers' money. In short, I believe savings and retail banks are best positioned to remain the trustworthy advisors to our customers for their financial planning, especially in the digital age. Besides the digital transformation, retail banking plays for sure a fundamental and growing role in the field of sustainable development, particularly in the transition to a carbon-free economy. In order to stay loyal to their commitments to decarbonization, banks must translate such transition in their balance sheets and financing activities. This will mean reducing emissions from their own operations as well as from their lending portfolios in line with net zero goals and science-based targets. Banks have many ways of reducing the climate impact of their business activities, including increasing their lending to renewable energy projects, eliminating financing of coal, issuing sustainability-linked loans, helping green businesses raise funds, or pursue deals, helping cooperation find and adopt new technologies that help them reduce carbon emission and many other choices. Products offered by banks also need to go greener to serve a large base of retail customers and partners who are interested in green finance. In particular, savings and retail banks are close to the people, to individuals like you and like I, and they are the natural partner to SMEs, fundamental to innovation. Our extensive practical and day-to-day knowledge of local industry and households have given us the tools to provide SME lending as well as give SMEs our support in making the transition to a more sustainable future. We are the link between their old business and a clean new one. This transition period is something that we see as key important for us to support SMEs to have a future also in this new kind of economy. Because of their share in emissions, households are also being offered attractive solutions to reduce their emissions. Already now, green mortgages and green loans are examples where ESPG members provide support and sustainable investment in local communities. There would be much more to say, but as we are already 4 minutes our the time that was given to us, I stop here at this point.
Thanks. Thanks very much, Peter, also being so conscious of the time. We are past three right now, and we have scheduled this for 1 hour, so I would close it now with these remarks from Peter. Sebastian Hospelier, thanks very much for participating and introducing to us the presidency of France in the area of banking and financial markets. Thanks for coming and taking the time. And Peter, also thanks very much to you for basically sharing your views about what the Savings Bank organization is thinking about these programs and also giving us your insight in terms of what digitalization and green transition means for the banking industry. Thanks very much, and all have a good day. And thanks also to the audience for listening in. Bye-bye.